Standing right in front of me is the United States Marine Corps' most advanced artillery system, known as HIMARS. And I'm here today at Camp Pendleton in California, joining the Marines at 111 to see the ins and outs of this weapon system, and of course, shoot some rockets. Before going into the training range, I first had to put on a ballistic vest and get inside this JLTV, which took me all the way to the launch site. Then all I had to do was to stand at a safe distance from the launcher. Well, not there, over here. Although HIMARS safety guidelines seem to be a bit more relaxed in Ukraine. But today's adventures did not begin on the training range. It started up in the control tower at the Marine Corps Air Station. The plan was for a KC-130J Super Hercules to land here and transport a HIMARS unit to a remote island where it would be conducting a live fire exercise. And this gave me the perfect opportunity to get my ears on, get on the ground, talk to the Marines, and for the first time, see the HIMARS in person. But how a HIMARS with a blue dot can shoot any type of missile? Why the cabin has window curtains and a hatch that opens on the top? What's the one type of target that HIMARS can't hit? And why the exercise ended with the use of fire extinguishers is not what you think. The HIM in HIMARS stands for High Mobility, but I had no idea the military needs shipping labels when air transporting a HIMARS. They used the label for tracking, and we had to blare some of the details for operational security, because we don't want to upset the ARS in HIMARS, which stands for Artillery Rocket System. But there was a problem. In its original configuration, a HIMARS would not fit inside the Super Hercules, even after folding down the HF antenna. To make it fit, they actually have to lower the vehicle's chassis and even deflate the tires. Thankfully, they don't need to do that manually. HIMARS is equipped with a central tire inflation system, or CTIS, which can inflate or deflate the tires as needed within minutes. This gives the HIMARS optimal traction, whether it's driving on sand or on a paved road. Speaking of driving, there are no backup cameras on this vehicle, so the driver needs external guidance to align the vehicle with the ramp. And within minutes, the HIMARS was inside the airplane. You might be wondering why there is a civilian boarding the airplane with the Marines. That's a Lockheed Martin employee, the manufacturer of HIMARS. Lockheed leverages the experience of Marine veterans and deploys them with the Marines to provide technical support with the launcher. And just like that, the HIMARS was on its way to a remote island to deal with a high-value target. But more on that later. If you ever get a chance to walk into a parking lot full of HIMARS launchers, you'd notice the state-of-the-art security measures that are in place to prevent unauthorized access. Why complicate things when you don't have to? But kidding aside, HIMARS is truly a one-of-a-kind artillery system, which is operated by just three people. The driver, who maneuvers the vehicle. The gunner, who receives the fire missions, enters them into the panel, and launches the missiles. And the chief, who sits in the middle of the two. The chief is the person who's ultimately in charge of the HIMARS and the safety of the crew. And you can easily identify the chief by looking to see whose head is sticking out of the cabin hatch. Which might seem strange, but there's a good reason for it. The HIMARS cabin is bulletproof, and that includes the windows, which are made of sapphire. That said, these windows are quite small, and even though the driver can easily see where he's going, the immediate surroundings are almost impossible to see from inside the cabin. Luckily, the chief can rise partway through the hatch to better observe the surrounding terrain so he can provide guidance to the driver. And in case he sees any threats, he has a machine gun to protect the crew. But how about at night? I spotted what looked like a camera on top of the cabin, and the chief confirmed it was indeed a night vision camera for when it gets dark. The chief also ensures that the launcher is not obstructed by any trees, and goes back inside the cabin just before the rockets are launched. By the way, these little curtains inside the cabin aren't there so the crew can have a nice afternoon nap. The flash from the rocket launch is so bright that these blackout curtains must be pulled over the windows prior to firing any rockets. But even more dangerous are the gases that surround the vehicle after each rocket launch. to protect the crew from inhaling these fumes, before launching the rockets, the cabin can be pressurized within a few seconds at the push of a button. After the HIMARS is unloaded from the transport aircraft, it goes into a hiding spot and waits there until an order comes in from the Fire Direction Center or FDC. The FDC is responsible for planning, coordinating, and directing artillery fire missions, and is typically concealed under a camouflage net. The enemy might be able to see that there is something here, but they wouldn't know if it's the FDC or a few Marines having lunch or just a decoy. If you're curious what inside the FDC looks like, you're in luck. There is one vehicle here that contains much of the communications and computation equipment. Of course, the screens had been turned around because we were there.
They'll be able to tell you how information flows here. You get a map on the other side, so if you just follow around the net, you'll be able to get to the center.
The platoon fire direction officer is the person who plots the targets on the map, then sends out the confliction data to be verified, which simply means they make sure the friendly forces are not within the impact area. Special instructions are then sent to the HIMARS units, indicating whether they should engage with a target at a particular time or just remain on standby until the FDC gives them the command to fire. Because of the critical role that the FDC plays, their whereabouts are kept a secret on the battlefield. But in case their location is compromised, the FDC can be packed up in under 3 minutes and transported to a new safe location. I guess everyone else has to go on foot or ride inside a JLTV, which by the way has amazing adjustable suspensions. And this helps make the ride a lot more comfortable on rough terrain. Once a HIMARS unit gets a command to fire, they come out of hiding and drive to a designated firing point. To hit the target accurately, it is important that HIMARS goes to the exact firing coordinates that have been computed and communicated by the FDC. Once in position, the gunner launches one or more rockets. The vehicle then quickly drives away to a new hiding spot, unless they need to go on firefighting duty. During hot summer days, the dry vegetation in California is a spark away from catching on fire. This means that the extreme heat from the rocket launches can easily set them aflame. Since this is a training area, the Marines carry multiple fire extinguishers inside the vehicle, and when needed, they get out of the cabin and quickly put out the fire before it gets out of hand. Firefighting duties, of course, won't be a priority for the Marines during actual combat. This pod has 6 GMLRS rockets, also known as GMLRS, which can hit a target up to 44 miles away, and they can do this extremely accurately. But once a HIMARS goes Winchester, meaning that it shoots all its rockets, it needs to be reloaded. This rearming process is not only efficient, but is also performed without any external help. Instead of reloading the pod with new rockets, HIMARS is designed to drop the spent pod and replace it all together with a brand new pod. The crew drive to a predetermined resupply point, where a loaded rocket pod would have been previously dropped by the logistics team. The reload process is pretty slick, but it requires the cooperation of the entire HIMARS crew. The gunner gets out of the vehicle and guides the driver to position the vehicle properly relative to the new pod that's on the ground. The crew also need to account for uneven terrain and keep the vehicle as level as possible so the crane can operate properly. The launcher is then rotated outward, the spent rocket pod is slid out and then hoisted down onto the ground. These operations are all being performed by one of the Marines with the help of a remote control. The new pod is then hooked in and hoisted up. The crane does most of the work, but some manual handling is still required. Finally, the pod slides into the launcher. Wait, what did the chief do? He supervised. But joking aside, supervising is arguably the most important step in troop leading. The expected time for the resupply process is just under 3 minutes, and for this reason, Marines train vigorously to achieve this level of efficiency. The crew then drive to a new hiding spot and wait on further orders from the FTC. The empty pods are picked up at a later time, potentially days later, by a different team. By the way, if you look closely, there is rifling inside the empty launch tubes. Similar to other artillery systems like howitzers, the spiral grooves would spin around as it gets launched. The spin significantly improves targeting accuracy by stabilizing the trajectory of the round. And as you'll see, the pods with the blue mark are especially accurate. Each HIMARS rocket costs a whopping $150,000. So in order to make training exercises more cost-effective, they don't actually fire the regular GMLRS rounds. Instead, these pods are loaded with reduced-range practice rockets, also known as RRPR rounds, which have a maximum range of 5.6 miles. These practice rounds are much more affordable, only costing $6,500 each. But this pod with the blue mark doesn't house your typical rockets, and it's called the Brain Pod. Instead of rockets, there are just some electronics inside the Brain Pod, which trick the HIMARS computers into thinking that there are actually rockets inside the pod, where there is none. In addition, the Brain Pod can simulate different types of missiles, like GMLRS, ATACMS, or anti-ship missiles. This effectively turns the HIMARS into a simulator and allows the crew to go through all the motions, including firing at a target without launching any physical rockets. In fact, it's thanks to the Brain Pod that we're able to capture this really cool footage of the launcher going into firing position. And to do that, the crew actually had to enter a target coordinates and simulate a fire mission. By the way, my apologies for the sweaty back, but to be fair, the ballistic vest that I was wearing weighs 30 pounds, and I've been wearing it all day on this notional remote island. Speaking of the remote island, remember that KC-130J that picked up the HIMARS? It landed on a dirt runway on a notional remote island where Marines were practicing Expeditionary Advanced Base Operations, or EABO. Of course, the island was just part of the practice scenario. The idea is simple: land in a remote location and using HIMARS roll-on-roll-off capability, unload the vehicle to quickly get to a nearby location and fire rockets at a high-value target. In this case, it was an anti-ship missile asset. This is just one of the many types of missions Marines can carry out during EABO. Once the rockets are on the way and the high-value target is destroyed, the HIMARS would sprint back to the aircraft, roll on, and the plane would leave immediately. But why go through so much trouble to just launch a missile? The hard truth is that once the rockets leave the launcher, it would be incredibly easy for the enemy to figure out where the missiles were launched from. Now, if you're on a continent or a really big island, it is possible to drive away into a hiding spot before firing again. Or in other words, engage in shoot and scoot. But if you're on a small island with one dirt runway and it's jungle all around you, say somewhere in the Indo-Pacific, you better leave the island as fast as you can before you're located by the enemy drones. Another big problem is that no matter how spread out and camouflaged HIMARS batteries are, they're always going to be limited in their presence by the range of their rockets. This means that HIMARS batteries would have to be deployed dangerously close to the enemy, within several hundred kilometers of the island of Taiwan or the Chinese mainland, if they are to be positioned strategically to counter or deter any potential military action by China in the region. It's worth noting that HIMARS bridges the gap between direct fire systems, short-range artillery systems, and longer-range missile systems, such as the Rogue Nemesis. HIMARS gives the Marine Corps the ability to control choke points and key terrain without naval support, and at a fraction of the cost of cruise missiles. This allows Marines to assist the Navy with dealing with enemy ships and also deny an adversary access to land. It's all a part of Marines' force design strategy for fighting the next war. Of course, you could also fire HIMARS from the flight decks of amphibious ships, which gives them the ability to fire missiles without having built-in VLS cells. But the tricky part is to compensate for the movements of the ship. Otherwise, the missile would lose some of its accuracy. The bigger issue is that ships move relatively slowly, and once the enemy identifies the estimated location of incoming rockets, it can target the ship with ballistic missiles. HIMARS may be accurate, but not for all types of targets. As part of an exercise in April 2023, the US Army tried to sink a decommissioned Philippine Navy corvette during a live fire exercise. In total, 6 GMLRS were launched by a HIMARS that was only 12 miles away. But every single rocket missed. That's because GMLRS are designed to hit grid targets, not moving targets. And the US Army admitted that it's exceptionally difficult to strike naval targets with HIMARS. So a Marine Corps F-35B Lightning II stealth fighter had to finish the job that HIMARS had started. But not for long, because Lockheed Martin's new precision strike missiles, or PrSMs, are capable of obliterating moving targets from over 300 miles away, even at sea. And we can't wait to come back to reunite with the Marines and their badass rocket launcher.